In our previous series of lectures on bioenergetics and oxidative phosphorylation, we learned about ATP molecules, biological oxidation reduction reactions, how electron motive force and proton motive force work in a biological system, and also about the flow of protons and electrons. We learned about glycolysis and how through a series of oxidation reduction and isomerization reaction, pyruvate is generated inside the cytosol. Okay, so this is what we have discussed so far. Glucose undergoes glycolysis to form pyruvate. The pyruvate can form glucose through gluconeogenesis. And pyruvate can also go into four different metabolic pathways. But the most common destination for pyruvate is to form acetyl-CoA. This acetyl-CoA enters the Krebs cycle or the citric acid cycle to generate NADH and FADH2 molecules. In the previous series of lectures on bioenergetics and oxidative phosphorylation, I told you that NADH and FADH2 are incredibly important molecules. And in this lecture, you will know why. These NADH and FADH2 produced by the Krebs cycle are used in a series of redox reactions that transfer electrons in the oxidative phosphorylation and generate massive amounts of ATP. So today we will talk about oxidative phosphorylation, which is also commonly known as electron transport chain. So let's get started. So first of all, what is the goal of electron transport chain? Well, the goal of electron transport chain is to couple energy stored in electrons acceptors to a proton gradient that drives ATP synthesis. The electron transport chain uses the electrons from the electron carriers to create a chemical gradient that can be used to power oxidative phosphorylation. Now, oxidative phosphorylation is a highly efficient method of producing large amounts of ATP, which is the basic unit of energy for metabolic processes. During this process, electrons are exchanged between molecules, which create a chemical gradient that allows for the production of ATP. Now, the most vital part of this process is the electron transport chain, which produces more ATP than any other part of cellular respiration. The electron transport chain is the final component of the aerobic respiration and is the only part of glucose metabolism that uses atmospheric oxygen. Electron transport chain is a series of redox reaction. We can say that it resembles a relay race. Electrons are passed rapidly from one component to the next to the end point of the chain, where the electrons get reduced and molecular oxygen produces water. Now, this requirement for the oxygen, the final stage of the electron transport chain, can be seen in the overall equation for the cellular respiration, which requires both glucose and oxygen. Now, all this will become more clear as we move forward, but before I start to explain the electron transport chain, first we need to design this chain so that you can imagine in your brains that how all this works, and you'll be able to understand it and comprehend it in a better way. So what you see here is the intermitochondrial membrane. Lower portion of the slide represents on the left side the mitochondrial matrix, and the top part represents the inner mitochondrial space. The outer mitochondrial membrane is readily permeable, you all know that, to a small molecules and ions which move freely through the transmembrane channels, formed by a family of integral membrane proteins, which are also known as porins. Now, the inner membrane is impermeable to most small molecules and ions, including protons. The only species that can cross through this membrane do so through specific transporters. The inner membrane bears the component of the respiratory chain and the ATP synthase. The mitochondrial matrix enclosed by the inner membrane contains the pyruvate dehydrogenase enzyme complex and the enzyme for the citric acid cycle for fatty acid oxidation pathways and the pathways of amino acid oxidation, which means all the pathways of oxidation except glycolysis, which takes place in the cytosol. This electrically permeable inner membrane segregates the intermediates and the enzymes of the cytosolic metabolic pathway from those of metabolic processes occurring in the matrix. However, specific transporters carry pyruvate, fatty acids, and amino acids or their keto derivatives into the matrix for access to the machinery of the citric acid cycle or the Krebs cycle. Now, ATP and inorganic phosphates are specifically transported into the matrix as newly synthesized ATP is transported out. On the right side of this slide, you can see mitochondria with its biochemical anatomy. The convolution, or we also call them the cristae, of the inner mitochondrial membrane provide a very large surface area. Now, this inner membrane of a single, for example, liver mitochondria may have more than 10,000 sets of electron transfer system or the respiratory chains, and the ATP synthase molecules, which are like distributed all over the membrane surface. In case of heart, the mitochondria in case of heart, which have like more perfused cristae and have a much larger area of the inner membrane, they contain more than three times as much sets of electron transport system as liver mitochondria. So that's a lot. Now, the mitochondrial pool of the coenzymes and intermediate is functionally separate from the cytosolic pool. Now, the mitochondria of the invertebrate plants and microbial eukaryotes are similar to the one which is shown here, but with a lot of variation in size, shapes, and the degree of cristae or convolutions of the inner membrane. Now, along this inner mitochondrial membrane, we have a series of complexes, as you can see here in different colors. For first of all, let me just let you understand what a complex is. Well, a complex is a structure consisting of a central atom, a molecule, or a proton, which is weakly connected to the surrounding atoms, molecules, or the protein. Now, in case of the electron transport chain, it is an aggregation of the complexes. Here you can see we have five complexes. They are numbered from complex number one, which is blue in color. Then we have complex number two, which is like pink. And then we have three and complex number four. And we have another complex number five, which is named as ATP synthase here. We will discuss this later, why I haven't named it as complex 5, but just ATP synthase. I'm going to discuss it with you later. Now, these complexes are associated with mobile electron carriers. Complex 5, which I told you, is a protein complex that contains two domains. One is called F0 domain that spans the inner mitochondrial membrane, and the other one is called as F1 domain, and that appears as a sphere that protrudes into the mitochondrial matrix. Of course, here for your understanding, I have not made those domain-like structures, just a triangle representing complex number 5 or ATP synthase. Now, this ATP synthase or complex 5 is called ATP synthase because it is the site of ATP synthesis. Now, additionally, we have two other molecules that act not as complexes, but they are embedded in the area of the electron transport chain. These are coenzyme Q and a cytochrome C. Now, technically, these compounds are broken down into two parts of oxidative phosphorylation. The complex portion from 1 to 4, including coenzyme Q and cytochrome C. This is known as the electron transport chain because this is where the electrons get shuffled from one complex to the other. All right. So the ATP synthase that pumps the electron against the proton gradient and generates ATP is technically known as chemiosmosis. Now, it is the combination of electron transport chain and chemiosmosis that is together known as oxidative phosphorylation. Now, the distinction is probably not very important for the sake of like an exam, but for keeping the big picture in your mind, you should know that if someone is referring to the oxidative phosphorylation, they are referring to the entire process. But if somebody is like talking about electron transport chain, they are technically talking about the movement of the electron from complex 1 to complex 2, 3, and then 4, and then to the oxygen. But they are not actually talking about the final ATP synthase, that is the pump that generates ATP. So each complex since we talked about complex, each complex accepts or donates electron to relatively mobile electron carriers such as coenzyme Q and cytochrome C. Each carrier in the electron transport chain can receive electrons from the electron donors and form an electron donor, and it can subsequently donate electron to the next carrier in the chain. The electrons ultimately combine with oxygen and proton to form water. Now, this requirement for oxygen makes the electron transport chain the respiratory chain. That's why we call it the respiratory chain, which accounts for the greatest portion of the body's use of oxygen. Now, the electron transport chain is present in multiple copies. You have to remember that. They are present in multiple copies, many copies, in the inner mitochondrial membrane of the eukaryotes and the plasma membrane of the prokaryotes. So, here is the big picture. Now, with the exception of coenzyme Q, all members of the chain are protein in nature. They may function as enzymes in case, like with the dehydrogenases, may contain an iron as a part of an iron sulfur center, which is on the right side, extreme right side of the picture, as you can see in the red box, and may be coordinated with a porphyrin ring, as in the cytochrome, or may contain copper, as does the cytochrome A-A3 complex. So first of all, let's talk about complex 1. Alright, so complex 1 is composed of flavin mononucleotide, or FMN, and an enzyme which contains iron sulfur, like the one which is on the right red box. Now, the FMN, or flavin mononucleotide, which is derived from the vitamin B2, that's why it's called riboflavin, which is vitamin B is called vitamin B2 is called riboflavin, is one of the several prosthetic groups or cofactors in the electron transport chain. Here, the formation of NADH takes place. Now, NAD positive, which doesn't have a hydrogen ion, is reduced by gaining a proton, NADH, by the help of dehydrogenases that remove two hydrogen from their substrate, both electrons, but only one proton, that is the anhydride ion, and is transferred. They transfer it to the NAD positive molecule, forming a NADH molecule along with a free protons. Now, the free protons plus the hydride ion carried by the NADH are next transferred to NADH dehydrogenase, which is actually the complex 1. Now, FMN accepts the two hydrogen atoms and become FMNH2. NADH dehydrogenase also contains iron atom paired with sulfur atoms to make an iron sulfur center, which is shown on the right side of the figure. Now, the complex 1 can pump 4 hydrogen ions across the membrane from the matrix into the intermediate space. It is in this way the hydrogen ion gradient is established and maintained between the two compartments separated by the inner mitochondrial membrane. These are necessary for the transfer of hydrogen atom to the next member of the chain, which is coenzyme Q. This coenzyme Q is also known as ubiquinone. Now, this coenzyme Q, or ubiquinone, is a quinone, and that has a long hydrophobic isoprenoid tail. It is also called ubiquinone because it is ubiquitous in biological system. Now, coenzyme Q is a mobile carrier. You have to keep that in mind, and it can accept hydrogen atom from FMNH2 produced on NADH dehydrogenase, which was complex 1, to form FADH2 molecule. Now, the coenzyme Q molecule, it is lipid soluble and freely moves through the hydrophobic core of the membrane. Okay, once it is reduced to its hydrogen carrying form, when it is converted into coenzyme Q with a proton, ubiquinone delivers its electron to the next complex in the electron transport chain, which is complex 2. Now, this complex 2 directly receives FADH2, which does not pass through the complex 1. Now, coenzyme Q receives the electron derived from NADH from the complex 1 and also the electron derived from FADH2 from complex 2, including the succinate dehydrogenase. Now, this enzyme and FADH2 form a small complex that delivers electrons directly to the electron transport chain, bypassing the first complex. Since these electrons bypass and thus do not energize the proton pump in the first complex, less ATP molecules are made from the FADH2 electrons. The number of ATP molecules ultimately obtained is directly proportional to the number of protons pumped across the intermitochondrial membrane. Then we move on to complex 3. Now the third complex, the complex 3, is composed of cytochrome B, another iron sulfur protein, and a cytochrome C protein. This complex is also called cytochrome oxidoreductase. Cytochrome proteins have a prosthetic heme group. The heme group is similar to the heme in hemoglobin and myoglobin that we discussed previously, but it carries electrons, not oxygen molecule like in hemoglobin. As a result, the iron ion at its core is reduced and oxidized as it passes the electrons, fluctuating between different oxidation states, that is from its reduced to oxidized form, from being converted from the ferric to ferrous ion. Now the heme molecule in the cytochromes have slightly different characteristics due to the effect of different proteins binding them, which makes each complex like complex, which makes each of the complex. Now the complex 3 pumps the protons through the membrane and passes its electron to cytochrome C for transport to the fourth complex of the proteins and enzymes. Cytochrome C is the acceptor of electrons from coenzyme Q. However, coenzyme Q carries pairs of electrons and cytochrome C can accept only one at a time. Then we have complex 4. The fourth complex, it is composed of cytochrome proteins C, A, and A3. This complex contains two heme groups, one in each of the cytochrome A and A3, and three copper ions. The cytochromes hold an oxygen molecule very tightly between the iron and the copper ion until the oxygen is completely reduced. Now this reduced oxygen then picks up the two hydrogen ions from the surrounding medium to produce water molecule. The removal of the hydrogen ion from the system also contributes to the ion gradient used in the process of chemiosmosis that we will discuss later on. So it was all about the electron transport chain, and now we talk about the other part of oxidative phosphorylation, which is chemiosmosis. Chemiosmosis is the movement of ions across a selectively permeable membrane down the electrochemical gradient. Now during chemiosmosis, electron carriers like NADH and FADH donate electron to the electron transport chain. The transfer of electron down the electron transport chain is energetically favored because NADH is a strong electron donor, we know that, and molecular oxygen is an electron acceptor. However, the flow of the electrons from the NADH to oxygen does not directly result in ATP synthesis. The electrons cause conformational changes in the shape of the proteins, and therefore it pumps proton across a selectively permeable membrane. The uneven distribution of the protons or the hydrogen ions across the membrane establishes both concentration gradient and electrical gradient. Thus an electrochemical gradient is generated owing to the hydrogen ions which are positively charged and their aggregation on one side of the membrane. Now, if the membrane were open to diffuse by the hydrogen ions, the ion would tend to spontaneously diffuse back across into the matrix driven by the electrochemical gradient. However, many ions cannot diffuse to the nonpolar regions of the phospholipid membrane without the aid of an ion channel. Similarly, hydrogen ions in the matrix space can only pass through the inner mitochondrial membrane through a membrane protein which is called ATP synthase, which was complex number 5. Right? You can see it in orange color in this diagram. Now this harnesses the potential energy stored in the hydrogen ion gradient to add a phosphate to ADP forming a adenosine triphosphate or an ATP molecule. So to understand all this, we look into the chemiosmotic hypothesis. Now this chemiosmotic hypothesis, which is also known as Mitchell hypothesis, explains how the free energy generated by the transport of electrons from the electron transport chain is used to produce ATP from ADP and an inorganic phosphate. Now the electron transport is coupled to the phosphorylation of ATP, ADP, adenosine diphosphate, by the transport, or we also call it the pumping of the protons across the inner mitochondrial membrane from the matrix to the intermembrane space at complex 1, 3 and 4. Now this process creates a electrical gradient with more positive charges, as I told you earlier, on the outside of the membrane as compared to the inside, and a pH gradient. The outside of the membrane, this gradient is at a lower pH than the inside. So the energy generated by this proton gradient is sufficient to drive ATP synthesis. Thus the proton gradient serves as the common intermediate that couples oxidation to the process of phosphorylation. So here is a detailed structure of the ATP synthase, which was previously I called it complex 5, but since it synthesizes ATP, that's why it's called ATP synthase, and in this figure it's blue in color and inverted. So you can see it's F0 domain and F1 domain. Now this enzyme complex ATP synthase synthesizes ATP using the energy of the proton gradient generated by the electron transport chain. The chemiosmotic hypothesis proposes that after protons have been pumped to the cytosolic side of the inner mitochondrial membrane, they re-enter the matrix by passing through a channel in the membrane spanning this domain, F0 domain, of the complex 5 or the ATP synthase, the one that you can see here in green in color, driving the rotation of the F0 and at the same time dissipating the pH of the electrical gradient. So F0 rotation causes a conformational change in the extramembranous F1 domain that allows it to bind to ADP along with the inorganic phosphate that phosphorylates ADP and produces and then releases a adenosine triphosphate or ATP molecule. Now chemiosmosis is used to generate 90% of the ATP made during aerobic glucose catabolism. The production of ATP using the process of chemiosmosis in the mitochondria is collectively called as oxidative phosphorylation. It is also the method used in the light reactions of photosynthesis to harness the energy of the sunlight in the process of photophosphorylation. The overall result of this reaction is the production of ATP from the energy of the electrons removed from the hydrogen atom. These atoms were originally part of the glucose molecule, as you remember, and at the end of the pathway, the electrons are used to reduce an oxygen molecule to oxygen ions. Extra electrons on the oxygen attract hydrogen ions, which are the protons, forming the surrounding medium, and as a result, water is formed. Now let's look at the total or net ATP yield in all those processes that we have studied so far. In case of a eukaryotic cell, the process of cellular respiration can metabolize one molecule of glucose into 30 to 32 ATP molecule. The process of glycolysis only produces 2 ATP, while all the rest are produced during the electron transport chain. Clearly, the electron transport chain is vastly more efficient, but it can only be carried out in the presence of oxygen. The number of ATP molecules generated through the catabolism of glucose can vary subsequently. For example, the number of hydrogen ions the electron transport chain complexes can pump through the membrane varies between the species. Another source of variance occurs during the shuttle of the electrons across the membrane of the mitochondria. Now, the NADH generated from glycolysis cannot easily enter mitochondria, you know that? And thus, electrons are picked up on the inside of the mitochondria by either NAD positive or FAD positive or flavin adenine dinucleotide molecules. Now, these flavin adenine dinucleotide molecules can transport less ions. Consequently, less ATP molecules are generated when FAD positive acts as a carrier. NAD is used as the electron transporter in the liver, and FAD is acts in the same way in the brain. Another factor that affects the yield of ATP molecule generated from glucose is the fact that intermediate compounds in these pathways are used for other processes as well. Glucose catabolism connects with the pathways that build or break down all the biochemical compounds in cell, but the result is not always ideal. For example, sugar other than glucose are fed into the glycolytic pathway for energy extraction. Moreover, the 5-carbon sugar that form the nucleic acids are made from the intermediates in the process of glycolysis. Certain non-essential amino acids can be made from intermediates of both glycolysis and the citric acid cycle as well. Lipids such as cholesterol and triglycerides are also from the intermediates in these pathways. And both amino acids and triglycerides are broken down for the sake of energy through these pathways. Overall, we can say that in living system, these pathways of glucose metabolism extract about 34% of the energy which is contained within the glucose molecule.